Greetings and welcome to the 154th session of the online Optom learning series for OLS. And I'm very happy to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Urmi Shah. Dr. Urmi is a cataract surgeon and a medical retina specialist. She consults at two ophthalmologic clinics in India, particularly in Mumbai at the Eye Solutions at Kemp's Corner and also the All Doctors Clinic at Walkeshwar. After completing her MBBS at the prestigious Seth GS Medical College and KEM Hospital in Mumbai, Dr. Urmi went on to do her master's in ophthalmology at Bangalore. On her return to Mumbai, she worked as an associate ophthalmologist at Drushti Eye and Retina Center and received her training in medical management of various retinal disorders. In addition to performing phacoemulsification cataract surgery, she is very involved in treating various retinal diseases such as diabetic retinopathy, vein occlusions, age-related macular degenerations, and actively involved in giving intravitreal injections as well. Dr. Urmi has given a very brief talk about OCT onto OOLS. And I think those who have not attended the talk, please do attend it if you would like to learn more about OCT. And those who are watching us on YouTube, we will put the link in the description as well. Welcome back, I would say, Dr. Urmi, onto our platform. And today she's going to talk about causes of reduced vision post-cataract surgery, which is one of the most common surgeries performed in ophthalmology, if I can put it that way. So over to you, Dr.
Thank you so much, Fakhruddin, for the kind introduction. And it's wonderful to be back here again with all of you. And I must congratulate all of you on how well OOLS is doing. 154th session is amazing in a span of a year and a half. So well done. As mentioned by Fakhruddin, the topic for today is causes of reduced vision post-cataract surgery. Now, as we know, cataract surgery is one of the commonest and most successful operations done worldwide across all specialties. And most of the times, the patient comes back smiling, very satisfied with the visual outcome. This is a typical cataract, a grade 2 to 3 nucleus sclerosis. Post-surgery, this is an ideal surgical outcome with the lens well in place, the cornea is clear, and the patient is extremely satisfied with the visual outcome. But at any point post-surgery, the patient may experience some difficulties in vision, and we need to understand the causes and treatments of the same. The basic causes for a reduced vision post-surgery, we can divide them under various headings, okay, based on the history. Today, as optometrists, you all would be the first line of contact, first point of contact for the patient. So any person who's coming back post cataract surgery with a drop in vision, these are the points that you need to check in the history and then go on to the examination. Most important is, when is the onset of drop in vision? When are the onset of symptoms? Is it immediately post cataract surgery? Is it in the early phase or is it in the late phase? So is it that the surgery has been done and at a day or two patient is saying he cannot see clearly? Is it that the surgery was done a week or two prior, or is it done a few months earlier? Along with that, what are the associated symptoms that the patient has? Along with the drop in vision, do they have any pain? Do they have any redness in the eye? Are they seeing any floaters? When the optometrist and the doctor, the ophthalmologist, examines them, you need to kind of identify what is the structure which is involved, which is causing the drop in vision. So is it because of a corneal pathology? Is it an inflammatory cause? Is it due to change in refraction? Is it related to the IOL? Is it a PCO, a posterior capsular opacification? Is it something to do with retina or is it a glaucoma? And eventually come down to the cause. Is this something which is caused by the surgery? Or is this a pre-existing condition which was not picked up before surgery and now post-surgery patient is not happy with their vision and we have realized that this was actually present beforehand? So we are going to touch on all these topics one by one, starting with the corneal causes of reduced vision. This, what we see here, is day one of a post-op patient. We can still see the air bubble in the anterior chamber. And this right here is a corneal edema. what we call as DM folds or Desmase folds. Extremely common post-surgery, post-cataract surgeries, especially on day 1-2. Okay. The causes, but not all patients get corneal edema, right? So what is the causes? Why would some patients get it and some patients don't have it? When you do a prolonged phaco in the AC, if there is more phaco power happening in the anterior chamber, the cornea will develop some amount of edema. That edema is more likely to be diffuse, as we saw in the previous picture. If there is any trauma during surgery, either with an instrument touch or a lens touch to the cornea, that can result in a localized edema. Post-surgery, a rise in IOP or excess inflammation. Sometimes if there has been a PC rent and there are vitreous strands which are adherent to the endothelium, a Desmase membrane detachment, toxic anterior segment syndrome, what we know as TAS, or a preoperative low endothelial cell count. All these are causes why the patient can have corneal edema post-surgery. So the onset of this edema is immediate. It happens day 1 will be the maximum and then it will reduce, And generally it is a painless condition unless it is associated with inflammation. So this is what we call as a striate keratopathy or DM folds, which typically by the 4th or 5th day is going to clear up and you're going to get a clear cornea like this. What is the treatment of this corneal edema? Number 1, eliminate the cause. If there is an excess inflammation, increase the frequency of steroids. If the IOP seems higher, lower the IOP. Remove any tissue IOL contact. Important to enhance the surface dehydration. So if we feel the striate keratopathy is more, giving hypertonic agents is very common. Hypertonic saline, which helps to dehydrate the cornea and reduce the striate keratopathy. In case the patient complains of pain, giving lubricants is helpful. This is another patient, okay, who had this on day 2, this kind of picture. However, on day 4, when you see, the edema is not resolved. In fact, it has become a little bit more whitish, little bit more well-defined. This kind of a keratopathy which does not resolve, in spite of increasing your steroids and hypertonic saline, and it's getting more well-defined by day 4, tells you that something else is going on. So you cannot just label it as a corneal edema post-surgery. Here we can see, so here also in the cross section, in the slit, we can see that in this area, actually the corneal thickness is significantly increased. At 3 months follow-up, the good part in this is that the area of corneal edema is below the pupil. The visual axis is spared, therefore the vision is 6-6-N6. At 3 months follow-up, however, when I enlarge this area, I can actually see that there is something happening there, looks like something is rolled up, folded there. This is actually a Desmase membrane detachment, which had happened during the surgery. Because the vision in this patient was always 6-6-N6 and it was below the visual axis, we had decided to leave this alone and not do anything about it. Because even if it heals by leaving a little opacity, it is not going to affect the vision. The treatment of a Desmase membrane detachment, if you notice it at the end of surgery, putting in an air bubble helps to tamponade the Desmase back in place. If we notice it post-surgery, we can take the patient back to OT and flatten out the Desmase membrane with an air bubble. Sometimes a larger detachment needs to be sutured. If it is not involving the pupillate area, it is small in size, you can leave it as I did in this patient. And if it eventually results in a large corneal opacity, then the patient might even require a corneal transplant or keratoplasty. Coming to the other important corneal cause of reduced vision is a pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. This typically has a late onset post-surgery and it is a painful condition. Basically, what happens is that any cause that causes a persistent edema in the cornea leads to formation of these bullae or vesicles on the cornea. These bullae are due to accumulation of the fluid. And these bullae or vesicles, they frequently burst and give rise to intense pain and ocular irritation as they burst. So either the cataract surgery has been complicated, okay, which has led to a damage to the corneal endothelium, a functional decompensation and subsequent edema, or there was an unhealthy endothelium to begin with, as we commonly see in a Fuch dystrophy or post attacks of acute ankle closure glaucoma. In which case, even a routine uncomplicated cataract surgery might lead to an excess endothelial cell loss and leads to corneal edema post-op. So normally we need a cell count of 500 cells per millimeter square to maintain normal transparency, and anything which causes excess cell loss will result in a corneal edema. So very briefly, this is typically the etiology. Preoperative factors could be there is a low endothelial cell count. Intraoperative, as we said, a complicated surgery where there's damage to the endothelial cells, either from trauma from instrumentation or an excess phaco power or a vitreous prolapse. Or postoperatively, there is excess inflammation, there is glaucoma, uncontrolled IOPs or IOL subluxation. Any of these which have damaged the corneal endothelium have now led to corneal edema. And if this corneal edema is not looked at and treated at that point and it stays persistent, that is when it eventually will result in a pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. So how do we prevent this? Specular microscopy is important in selected cases to know what is the cell count when we are suspecting of Fuchs dystrophy. If we know that yes, the cell count is lower, using an adequate viscoelastic, especially a cohesive viscoelastic, to protect the endothelium during surgery, and during surgery, very careful instrumentation, making sure nothing comes in contact with the endothelium to protect the endothelial cells. So this is how we would prevent a corneal edema. What is the treatment? For pain, putting on a bandage contact lens helps, giving hypertonic saline drops to help to dehydrate the cornea. But eventually, when nothing works, the patient might have to go in for a keratoplasty. This is something where I would like you all to think as to if you can guess the diagnosis. This is the first patient. He had an uneventful cataract surgery. The cataract surgery was very smooth. The cornea was clear. At 1 month follow-up, his best corrected visual acuity was 6x12 N10. Now, when we see this kind of vision at 1 month post-op, the first thing is to do an OCT because you want to see is there any macular edema. The OCT was also very hazy, but through that we could make out that yes, there is no CME. But my AR, my autoref, is showing me variable readings. As I can see here, my cell is varying from 0.75 to 2.75, 1.25. The axis is changing 12, 34, 177. So at this point, I would like, if anybody wants to guess as to what is going on.
So I have a response saying that it could be due to corneal edema or due to the suture on the cornea.
Okay.
DMD, I think, decimex membrane detachment probably.
Okay.
Okay, so a couple of different responses on different thought processes.
Right. So I guess looking at the cell, yes, you are thinking of a suture on the cornea, but that would not cause this fluctuation in readings that I'm seeing. My cell would then be consistent across my different AR readings. It would not fluctuate from a minus 2.75 to a minus 0.5. So that is a clue. A corneal edema or DMD would have been picked up during the course. Okay, and we would know that. Yes, so I think somebody is come up with the correct diagnosis that this is a dry eye.
Dry eye, yeah.
Yes, so this is typically what we see in patients who have dry eye. Dry eyes are very common post cataract surgery, post any surgery, because you're cutting the corneal nerves when you make your incisions. And it is what is going to cause fluctuating AR readings. The other clue is that the OCT is hazy as you're trying to capture it. Okay, so what we did in this patient is, put in 3-4 drops of the lubricating agent, then repeated the AR and refraction, and his vision improved to 6-6 parts N6. So please think of this diagnosis when you have worked up the patient for other things, when you have seen the cornea is clear, when you've seen that there is no CME, the retina is fine. It could just be something as simple as a dry eye, and all the patient needs is lubricating drops. Post-surgical dry eyes. A couple of more examples. Post-surgical dry eyes can present in a number of different fashions. The second patient, where everything was fine post-op, routine uncomplicated surgery, all he had was watering from the eyes when he's stepping out in the sun. So he's not able to take the bright light, and that is causing the watering. Third patient comes back 1 week after stopping the drops, after we finish the 1 month of steroid drops. After stopping that, comes back with redness, photophobia, watering and bright light. Of course, any patient who comes back a week after stopping the drops, the first thing we think of is inflammation, that he's got some rebound uveitis after stopping the drops. But when we examine the patient, the AC was quiet. So in this case, we gave lubricants to the patient because dry eyes will also present with redness, photophobia and watering. And patient had a dramatic improvement in their symptoms in a few days. What are the causes of post-surgical dry eyes? Prolonged treatment with drops which have preservatives. Sometimes patients might need steroid drops for a longer time. Corneal incision, as I said, because we end up cutting the nerves. Patient might have a pre-existing dry eye, or sometimes a longer surgical time where there is more exposure to the light from the operating microscope. Sometimes it could be neither of these. It's a routine treatment. The surgical time has been normal, but the patient still develops the dry eyes. So important to keep that in mind, diagnose it and treat it accordingly. What are the symptoms? As I have already mentioned, routine symptoms, what we experience in any patient of dry eyes, even if they've not been operated: grittiness, heaviness, sensitivity to light, pain, watering, fluctuating vision, not happy with vision. Patient comes back and tells you that I'm not happy with my vision, even post-surgery. Put them on a lubricant. Always rule out other causes of reduced vision, which are important, like a cystoid macular edema or inflammation, before we attribute it to dry eye. Just thinking of dry eyes, we should not miss the more important causes. But when we know that all of that is fine, then yes, definitely put the patient on lubricants. Lubricating drops, very helpful. Supplementing with oral omega-3 fatty acids, again, will be quite helpful. Okay. Coming to the next cause, which can have a reduced vision post-surgery, is post-op inflammation. Normally, any intraocular surgery is going to be associated with inflammation as an inflammatory response. Normally, this would clear up by 1 to 2 weeks. And after 2 to 3 weeks, there would be no inflammation with your normal regular tapering steroids. What are the red flag signs when you know you have to look out for something more? When the inflammation stays longer than this, or it is not responsive to your regular topical steroids, if the patient develops a pain, redness, or drop in vision, and if the patient develops a hypopyon or vitreous cells, these are your red flag signs. What are the causes? Why would some patients have inflammation which stays longer than others? Whether if they had a pre-op uveitis, pre-op diabetes is one of the causes when they might have a little longer inflammation. Intraoperatively, excessive manipulation of the iris, a PC rent with vitreous loss, prolonged surgical time. Also, sometimes if there is some part of the lens which is left behind, a residual cortex or nuclear material can also result in an inflammation which stays longer. Some IOL factors, ACIOLs, which are done very rarely now, but they can irritate the iris and cause the inflammation. Sulcus IOLs, drug induced, as we know that prostaglandins, latanoprost and myotics, both are known to cause a little inflammation. And finally, the most dreaded cause, which nobody wants, which is infection or endophthalmitis. What are the signs and symptoms? Pain, redness, lid edema, drop in vision. This is a patient who came back again after an uncomplicated surgery on post-op day 2. Vision was 618 parts N12 and the anterior chamber had a significant amount of cells and flare. And she has this lid edema and patient is not comfortable. So what do we do? Stepped up the steroids and over time she was fine. Why does the inflammation cause a drop in vision? Inflammation may be associated with some corneal edema. Excess inflammation may be associated with fibrin in the AC or even a pupillary membrane or even vitritis. All of these can cause a drop in vision. How do we manage this? First thing is increase the frequency of topical steroids. Okay, follow up this patient carefully to see how it is progressing. Okay, if even after increasing the frequency is not coming under control, we can do a gonioscopy to look for any retained lens matter in the angle somewhere which is not seen normally on slit lamp. We can even do a UBM at some point in the future to see the IOL position if it's a lens in the sulcus, whether that is the cause of excessive inflammation. Normally, this is managed medically. When do we intervene surgically? If the patient has a significant visual loss, if the inflammation is not being controlled, if there is a glaucoma developing or if the patient has a hyphema, what would you do surgically? Remove if there is any residual cortex or nuclear materials, remove that. If there is an iris which is adherent to the wound, release that. Sometimes it might even need a repositioning or an exchange of the IOL. As we can see in this patient, he had iris prolapse that was happening during surgery, okay, which is why this area has undergone atrophy of the iris. And because of that, the pupil is not constricting so well. He had a complicated surgery. He also had a rent and some vitreous loss. All of that was managed. And however, the IOL is in the sulcus, which is why there is a capture out here behind the iris. And because of this contact between the iris and the IOL, the patient was having persistent low-grade inflammation. So we went in and released the iris and kind of released the adhesions, pushed the IOL back, and post that the patient was doing fine. So sometimes when the inflammation is not controlled medically and we do identify a cause like this, it is important to correct that so that the patient feels better. Coming to the most dreaded complication that no cataract surgeon wants to think about is endophthalmitis, which is infection post cataract surgery. There are a number of different causes, multifactorial causes, why a patient might develop endophthalmitis. It depends on the patient's inherent flora, their immunity, what is the environment in the OT, what are the sterilization protocols. Very important to make sure the patient does not have uncontrolled sugars. Very important to make sure there is no pre-existing infection, because operating in these settings means you're setting yourself up for trouble. The onset of endophthalmitis could be early, which happens in days to weeks, or it could even be late, where it happens months to years later, and generally associated with pain. What are the clinical features? Patient will come to you. The most common symptom is a drop in vision post-surgery. Patient will come with pain, which is not there in all the cases, but a lot of cases do have pain. Important to know that the pain is worsening. Sometimes post-surgery, they can have some amount of pain on the same day, but that typically would get better by day one, day two, and then they will be pain-free. So if the patient complains of a pain which is worsening, or they did not have pain and now they have new onset pain, that is your red flag sign. When you examine, there would be, patient says that there is redness, excessive watering, not able to tolerate light, photophobia, blepharospasm. What do you see when you examine the eye? There is conjunctival congestion, there is chemosis, cornea might be edematous, severe AC reaction with fibrin, hypopyon. If you see a hypopyon, you do not wait. You treat this as an endophthalmitis. Pupil might become sluggish, there might be vitreous involvement. IOP could be generally low, sometimes can even be high. Okay, and there would be tenderness digitally when you try to do a digital IOP. How do you manage endophthalmitis? Close monitoring is very important. Very important to differentiate whether this is a sterile inflammation or is it an infectious endophthalmitis. As we spoke earlier, sometimes the inflammation in some patients can persist longer, or it might be a little bit more resistant and might need a little bit more aggressive topical treatment. So very important for the treating doctor to differentiate whether this inflammation is sterile or is it an infectious endophthalmitis. How would we do that? An infectious endophthalmitis would have a rapid worsening from the presentation. The sterile inflammation would normally be stable or show some improvement. It is not, if it's worsening very rapidly, you would think of infectious endophthalmitis. How are we going to diagnose it? Looking at the clinical picture, as I mentioned, vitreous involvement, presence of an hypopyon, presence of pain, all these are your red flag signs. Doing an ultrasound is helpful because it shows the involvement of the vitreous. The definite diagnosis is done by an aqueous or vitreous tap, aqueous and vitreous tap, and even a vitreous biopsy can be done. Of course, the treatment of endophthalmitis is quite an extensive topic and I will not go into details, but typically it would involve putting the patient on oral or IV steroids and antibiotics, giving intravitreal injections. After that, if it doesn't resolve, a vitrectomy is required, and at times even the IOL might be there might be a need to explant the IOL, take out the IOL. From the point of view of this talk, very important to know when to suspect endophthalmitis so that the patient can be monitored accordingly. Okay. Coming to refractive errors post-surgery. Yes, today cataract surgery, it has become almost a refractive procedure where we are making the patients free of glasses, monofocal lenses, multifocal lenses. But in spite of all that, sometimes patients might end up with some refractive errors. So let's look at that. Whenever the person comes back to you with a drop in vision or not happy with their vision post-surgery, very important to check the pinhole vision, as we would do in anybody who has not been operated. So if there is a pinhole improvement, we know that we need to look at a refractive error. If there is no pinhole improvement, we know that we need to look at some other causes. Sometimes the eye which is operated might not have a refractive error, a residual refractive error, but there might be anisometropia, because one eye has been operated and it has now become plano, the other eye still has a higher refractive error, either a high minus or a high plus, because of which the patient is not happy binocularly. In which case, when we know that patients have higher refractive errors pre-op, they need to be counseled that even if the other eye does not have a significant cataract, you might need to do the other eye in quick succession to make yourself happy with vision binocularly. Sometimes they may be left with some amount of residual myopia or hyperopia due to IOL power calculations, miscalculations. The commonest, however, what we see are the cylindrical errors. Cylindrical errors would stay either because the patient has a pre-op sill which has not been addressed during surgery, either because of the incisions and the healing or presence of sutures. Coming to a patient example, this patient had 3 sutures post-surgery. The vision was 636, improving with pinhole to 69. So we know, okay, it's going more in favor of a refractive error. And look at the AR, however. There is a very high sill, minus 5.25. Post-suture removal, the vision improves with pinhole to 66 and the sill has come down to 2.75. So 2.5 diopters drop of sill just by suture removal, that is the effect that sutures would have on their refractive error. Okay, coming to the IOL related causes of reduced vision post-surgery. Sometimes the IOL design might be faulty, which is resulting in a chronic inflammation. Sometimes the size might not be appropriate, which is leading to unacceptable lens mobility and an uncomfortable inflamed eye. An incorrect dioptric power, which is what we've spoken about, which results in anisometropia, other refractive symptoms. If there is an AC IOL, then it can cause uveal irritation. And with PC IOL, which is the commonest type of IOLs now implanted, anything which causes a decentration of the IOL can affect the vision, which could happen if there's an inadequate capsular or zonular support, pseudo exfoliation, asymmetric placement of the haptics, later on zonular dehiscence, enlargement of a ND-YAD capsule opening or post-operative trauma. If the IOL has been dislocated or decentered, what it results in is, if it's an AC IOL and it's decentered, it will result in the typical UGH syndrome, uveitis, glaucoma, hyphema. It can result in corneal decompensation or CME. The commonest IOL, which is the PC IOL, if that gets decentered, then those symptoms are primarily visual or optical in nature. So patient will have blurred vision, they might have diplopia, they might have glare because the IOL has got decentered and the IOL edge has come into the visual axis or even the rotating holes. Because of any of this, the patient might have any of these visual symptoms. How do we manage it? We try to initially manage it non-surgically. So to give them steroids for inflammation, give them NSAIDs for the CME, give miotics. If the IOL has, PC IOL has got decentered and some part of it has come in the visual axis, giving a miotic and constricting the pupil might help to remove that effect of the edge of the glare of the edge. However, if these don't work, then eventually they might require surgical treatment, which might involve IOL repositioning, IOL explantation, or even an IOL exchange. Okay, coming to posterior capsule opacification, a very, very common cause of reduced vision post-surgery. This is a very dense PCO, okay, a good slit lamp image that we managed to get. The onset of a PCO can be either early or late, and it is typically a painless condition. There is no pain which is associated. Two patient examples. This is one patient who presented many years after cataract surgery. Significant drop in vision because, as you can see, it's a very dense PCO. The vision was less than 660, less than N36. This is a second patient who has presented 1 month after surgery. The visual acuity is 6x6 N6. Okay, but the patient is not happy with vision as compared to the other eye. Both eyes have been operated. One eye has, for some reason, developed an early PCO. Both eyes are at 6x6 N6, but the patient is not happy. She keeps saying, when I close one eye, with the other eye, I'm not happy with the quality of vision I'm getting. So this is the entire range with which a PCO can present. With a perfect vision, but the quality vision affected, to a significant drop in vision. Treatment of PCO, as everyone knows, very simple, very straightforward. Do an ND-YAD capsulotomy, right? Make an opening in the PC, and the patient who had a vision of less than 660 dramatically improves to 66 N6. Right? Visual axis has been cleared and the patient goes home extremely happy. Coming to a very important topic, which is retinal causes of reduced vision, a little more serious than the refractive error. So I would like to divide the retinal causes into two typical groups. One is a condition which is induced by the surgery, a post-surgical cause, Okay, commonest being a macular edema, which could be either a CME or a worsening of diabetic edema, occurrence of a retinal detachment or a choroidal hemorrhage. The other group is pre-existing retinal conditions, which have for some reason been missed before the surgery and which is now causing the drop in vision. ERMs, macular holes, wet ARMDs, we'll go through the entire list. Cystoid macular edema, a very, very common cause of unexpected poor vision post-surgery. The onset, again, it could be early or late, generally not associated with pain unless there is inflammation which is causing the CME. There could be some surgical complications which make the chances of having CME higher, like if there is an iris which is incarcerated in the wound which is causing the inflammation, if there has been a vitreous loss and some anterior vitreous adhesions, IOL, pupillary captures, AC inflammations, any of these could cause the CME. Easily diagnosed by OCT, this is a typical picture of CME. Initially, we used to do the angiographies, which used to describe CME as the typical flower petal appearance. Now, of course, very, very easily picked up with OCT. This was a patient, vision was 680 in N12 paths, and this is what the OCT showed. Treatment, again, either step up or restart the topical steroids, depending on when the patient has presented. Topical NSAIDs really help, oral Dymox. Chronic unresponsive cases might respond to anti-VEGF injections, and very rarely a vitrectomy might help. Diabetic retinopathy, typical pictures of diabetic retinopathy showing you the hard exudates and the dot plot hemorrhages, microaneurysms. Okay, this was his OCT picture. Vision was at 618 N24. Very important to do OCT in all diabetic patients before cataract surgery. So that we know what the retina looks like and we know what to expect post-surgery. If the patient has a macular edema like this, first treat the edema and then do the cataract surgery. This could be done either by giving an intravitreal steroid or anti-VEGF before the surgery, maybe a few days prior, or even doing it at the end of surgery. If only cataract surgery is done and edema is not treated, then the patient is never going to be happy with the results. Because even post-surgery, they are not going to see well because of the edema and they will not appreciate a well-done cataract surgery. Retinal detachment post-cataract surgery, pseudophakic RD. The onset is generally late, generally occurs within the first year. Again, a painless condition. Patient will present with the typical features of an RD. Sudden painless drop in vision, might be seeing floaters. The vision will depend on the extent of the RD, whether the macula is involved or not. They may have a significant drop in vision, or they may just feel they're not seeing things clearly in a particular quadrant or just not happy with the vision. Again, typically how RDs present. What are the risk factors? PC tears with vitreous loss. If vitreous is adherent to the anterior structures, which causes traction at the vitreous base, which can lead to formation of tears, or pre-existing retinal tears, which have not been treated, or even doing a YAG capsulotomy at times can cause formation of a tear and RD because of the vitreous pull. How do we prevent it? Attempt to keep the PC intact during surgery. In case there is a PC loss, then make sure all the vitreous has been cleared and there is no vitreous still adherent to the AC which can cause continuous traction. Careful dilated fundus evaluation before cataract and before YAG capsulotomy, so that if there is any retinal lesions, again treat them before doing the YAG cap. And treatment of all retinal lesions with laser prior to surgery. If the patient does develop an RD post-surgery, the treatment is like treatment for any other RD with surgery. Just to show you a patient example, this was the retinal hole and this is which has been treated with laser. So this is what needs to be done before a cataract surgery. Choroidal hemorrhage, not going to talk too much about it. Quite rare, but one of the most dangerous complications post-cataract surgery. The suprachoroidal hemorrhage can happen on table, it can happen just post-surgery, it can be, God forbid, an expulsive hemorrhage. Okay, this is a patient where the B-scan is showing the choroidal hemorrhage, the AC has a total hyphema. Can try to treat it medically with topical steroids, control the IOP, vitrectomy might be required. Okay, most of the times a very poor prognosis. Okay, coming to the other topic, important topic of pre-existing retinal conditions. I think this is very relevant because a patient is not going to come to you saying that they have a cataract. A patient is going to come to you saying that they are not seeing things clearly. And we are the ones who have to diagnose and tell them that yes, is your drop in vision because of the cataract? Or do you have something else along with the cataract? Or is your lens clear and the drop in vision is primarily due to some other cause? Once that diagnosis is clear, the treatment can be planned out accordingly. And even if there is a retinal condition which is not possible to treat and the patient opts to go for the cataract surgery, the expectations are clear, where we give them the visual prognosis saying that, look, you have this pre-existing retinal condition, so even after surgery, you might not have the quality of vision that you are expecting. Okay, at an optometry level, how do we think on the lines of retinal conditions? Even before we look at the fundus is what I'm going to talk about. The pre-existing conditions could be a condition to do with the disc, commonest being glaucoma, or various different retinal conditions. Okay, let's talk about glaucoma. Cataract and glaucoma coexisting, very common. Both are conditions which get worse with age. And you will see a lot of patients who will walk into your clinics with where they have both diagnosed or undiagnosed. So how do we approach this? Let's look at a couple of different patient examples. First patient, vision is 6/6 N6, come for a routine checkup, doesn't really complain of a drop in vision, cataract is early, grade 1 to 2 NS, but the discs are not looking good. The discs are looking glaucomatous. In this patient, follow up the patient, first of all, do the test for glaucoma, see if they have glaucoma, diagnose it, and as you follow up, keep a watch on the cataract and the glaucoma both. Second patient, vision in both eyes individually 6/9 N6, early cataract, but pressures are borderline. Pressures are high, in fact, 20/24. This is the RNFL, which shows that yes, he does have thinning of the nerve fiber layer. So this patient was diagnosed with glaucoma, put on the appropriate management. Yes, in due course of time, as we follow up, if the cataract advances, cataract surgery will be required. But very important to work up and start the treatment for glaucoma. If this is not done, then the drop in vision could be either the glaucoma progressing or either the cataract progressing or the glaucoma progressing. That's why it's important to keep a watch on both. And for patient with uncontrolled pressures, it's important to control the IOP before we go in for a cataract surgery. Third patient, more important, right eye vision is okay, 6/9 N6, left eye 6/9 N10. Yes, the patient is probably, I think, 70-75 year old, has a cataract. But is this cataract the cause of this vision, 6/9 N10? And this is primarily what we need to be able to diagnose. Pressures were high when he came in, 26 and 30 in the left eye. Did an OCT, shows thinning, significant thinning in the left eye. And let's just see what has come up on the perimetry. Look at that, right? So right eye definitely has field loss, left eye has advanced field loss, being left with just the central island, concentric loss. So this guy, before we go ahead and treat this cataract, we need to bring the glaucoma under control, stabilize the pressures, repeat the perimetries, follow it up, and then eventually in due course of time, plan for the cataracts. Why is it important to diagnose the glaucoma beforehand? Because we know whether the vision loss is because of a cataract or glaucoma. We need to control the IOPs. We cannot do a cataract surgery with an IOP of 30. And sometimes, if the glaucoma is not coming under control with medications, he might even need a trap, in which case, he might choose to do a combined surgery of a cataract plus trap. Okay. Coming to other retinal conditions which need to be diagnosed pre-op, pre-cataract. This patient, vision 6/6 N6. However, in the left eye, the fovea is not looking as good as the right eye. I'm not seeing the foveal reflex. Let's see what the OCT shows. There you go. She has an ERM, right? Again, we don't want to do anything about it right now because the vision is 6/6 N6, but we will definitely follow her up with serial OCTs. When she needs the cataract, assess what is the condition of the ERM at that time. Does she need a combined surgery, cat plus vitrectomy, or do we do the cataract and then follow up the retina? Wet ARMD, again a very important condition in older patients. This particular gentleman presented in 2018 with a vision of 6/12 N10, okay, and had this wet AMD which showed up on OCT. Very important, if this had been only a cataract, I am not expecting the near vision to go down to N10. with a distance vision of 6/12. If this was only a cataract, I would have expected with a 6/12, my near vision would have been at N6 or maximum N6 parts. So the fact that the patient is presenting with a vision of 6/12 N10 means I have to look beyond the cataract and see what is going on in the retina. And this is what he did have. He had this wet AMD. He came back 2-3 years later with a bleed, significant worsening of the AMD. He refused to get treated actually at this point. He said, I'm happy with my vision, I don't want to treat it. However, when he came back with a significant drop in vision, he's now on anti-VEGF injections for the same. Another patient with a wet AMD, 660 N24, good glow. Why has my near vision dropped so much, right? Again, with a 660, if it was due to a cataract, number one, I would see a significant cataract, enough to cause a 660. Number two, again, my near vision might be around 6.6, 6.8. N6, N8. It's not going to go to N24. So this is my cue that yes, I need to look at the retina. This lady actually had IPT, parafoveal telangiectasis. We can see the pigmentation here. We can see the changes on the OCT. Full thickness macular hole. Retina, left eye is okay. Right eye, I can see the hole here. Vision again, 6.36, N24. This is the OCT. Traction, and we can actually see the hole here in the retina. Again, other causes, CRVOs. This was a patient with ischemic CRVO, severe drop in vision. Vision was just hand movements. Okay, again, with a cataract, you're not expecting hand movements vision. So yes, please look at the retina. A patient with a branch vein occlusion, vision 6/24, again at N10, right? Has macular edema because of the VRVOs. Treat with anti-VEGF injections. So, in all of these cases, either the visual acuity, all of these cases in which they have some pre-existing retinal condition, either the visual acuity is significantly low, less than 660, in which case the cataract has to be significant to cause this kind of a low vision, or the near vision has dropped significantly, out of proportion to the distance vision, which gives a clue that we have to look at the retina, look for retina or glaucoma issues. The only time when a cataract will cause more of a near vision drop is if it's a PSC or a posterior polar cataract. The closer the cataract is to the posterior pole of the lens, yes, it can affect near vision to some extent, but that is going to be picked up on the slit lamp. So if you have a patient who walks in with maybe a grade 2 cataract, vision is 6/12 N10, do not dismiss it just as a cataract. Look at the retina, do the OCT and figure out what else is going on. Just to summarize, thorough retinal evaluation before surgery to look for other causes of drop in vision. Any patient of reduced vision post-surgery, number one, check the pinhole vision, gives us a clue if it's due to a refractive error or due to some other cause. Check near vision. All post-op patients check near vision. If it is reduced out of proportion, gives a clue for a macular cause, again, most likely a CME. So the patient was fine post-op, 6.6 N6, has come back a few months later with 6/12 N10. Do an OCT, most likely you'll find a CME. And if, like the patient example I described, if there are fluctuating AR readings, fluctuating patient responses, then keep dry eye in mind, put in lubricants and repeat your tests, and the patient will be happy. Thank you so much.
Great. So thank you so much, Dr. Omi. Very, very comprehensive, I would say. I think you did cover the pre-op as well as the post-op complications, yes, as well, because that's really important for us to know, before we, as optometrists, when we want to refer patients to you, at an ophthalmology level, whether this patient will be a suitable candidate for cataract and, or we need to refer it for a retinal condition. So that's really important. Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. One question which I had is, a generic question like as an optometrist, when we work together, what do you really expect us to do after you have performed the surgery? So do you have things in place like we should do these tests before we even send them to you?
After surgery or before surgery?
Post-surgery.
So what I tell all of the optometrists who I work with is that every visit when you check vision, please check near vision.
Okay.
Near vision is very, very, we don't give it the importance that it deserves, but it can give us a big clue. Today, even before the patient walks into my room, if I open the chart and I see that the near vision has dropped, I might even ask him to just do an OCT and come in.
Okay.
because I know I might be looking at a cause of CME or something which has caused the drop in near vision, right? Other than that, pinhole vision, as I said, important to know that is it just a refractive error or is it something else that we are dealing with?
Yeah.
And a good history, I would say. I mean, patients who are happy, there is no problem. But patients who are not happy, what kind of complaint, difficulty are they experiencing? Are there any other symptoms? As we said, any floaters, any pain, photophobia, you know, which can give a clue as to what we are dealing with if the patient is not happy post-surgery.
That's great. Okay, so I do have a couple of questions here. We did talk about vision and everything.
Yeah.
Does IOL cause any aberrations? And do you want to comment on this in relation to the effect of vision, probably, you know? Because
when I think IOL induced aberration is not really in the purview of this talk.
Yes.
So I think we can always touch on that at a later time.
Yeah.
This is more to do with, you know, the other causes of the reduced vision that we are commonly encounter.
Yeah. So this is not particularly, I would not, correct me if I'm wrong, that I would not put it as a complication.
Yeah.
Right. It's not something which is as a complication. It's something which comes along and we need to try to manage it. Right.
Correct.
Yeah.
And also what kind of lens the patient is going in for and explain to them what they can expect.
Yeah.
With the whole trend shifting so much towards multifocal lenses, let the patients know what they are going in for. They're not only becoming glasses free. There is some other complication that come along with multifocal, some other visual phenomena. Educate them and let them take an informed decision as to what they want to go in for.
Great. And anything particular you would emphasize on contrast sensitivity and contrast being affected post surgery? Would you consider contrast reduction as a complication post cataract surgery? Would that give you some clue to pick you up for some condition?
Contrast can reduce with a multifocal IOL, because as we know, the light rays which are coming in are getting divided into two different foci for distance and near. Okay, in a monofocal lens, we are not expecting contrast to reduce. In fact, patients typically come back to us and say, I'm seeing colors much better, much brighter. Some patients have come back and said, I'm seeing too well. I don't want to see this well, because they're used to that gradual decrease in the contrast, gradual decrease in the color saturations over the years as the cataract is getting sclerotic. And suddenly when that comes out and we have a clear lens, they're seeing things very brightly. So with monofocal lens, we don't expect it. With a multifocal lens, yes, it can be.
Yeah. Okay. And I mean, this is again something very common, but would you want to just summarize it as probably why is it important is I'm just trying to relate this into our clinical practice.
Yeah.
When patients comes in, probably how should we be explaining this to our patients? What do you think is a good way to explain here to the patients when we are sitting on the examination chair?
Correct. So typically what a lot of patients do ask is that after you take off the cataract, can the cataract come back?
Yes.
Because in a lot of other medical specialties, they do explain chances of recurrence, that you do this surgery, but however, you might have to undergo it again in a couple of years, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a very common question, that if I take off the cataract now, can it come back? That is when we need to explain that the cataract does not come back, but you can get something known as an after cataract or what we call as the PCO. So what I typically do is I explain to them how we have a bag which is left behind into which the IOL is implanted, and that bag itself can develop a PCO at any point. Also telling them that the treatment of that is much simpler than a surgery. I explain to them that the treatment of that is done on this very chair where you're sitting in the outpatient by a laser procedure, which is going to take not more than 5 minutes. It is not a surgery. You go home without a bandage on the eye. So they know that even if it does occur at any point, the treatment is not something that they should be very worried about.
Okay. Great.
Yeah.
And I think this question particularly talks about why does it occur? So I think that's again something.
It's a theoretical thing where we know that, you know, the cells are migrating and they're forming a layer on the posterior capsule between the IOL and the capsule. There are a lot of, there are IOL factors which you can look at. There are some changes in the IOL designs, in the edges, which are supposed to limit the formation of PCO. Mm-hmm. Okay. But either ways, it is quite a straightforward condition with a straightforward treatment. So, you know, I wouldn't worry too much about it. The importance is before doing the PCO to do the retinal exam to make sure that your simple procedure of YAG does not result in a complication in the retina, NRD. That is important.
That is important. Yep.
Yeah.
Great. And looking at some other questions, yeah. I think you did cover a bit on this particular question onto your talk, is how would you manage patients with lens dislocation? Would you want to just brief us about what should be the management plan?
If the patient has post-surgical lens dislocation, so it depends on what is the extent of the dislocation, right? If it is a slight shift in the bag, if the patient is okay, does not have too much of visual issues, like I said, we can give them even meiotics to make sure that, you know, the edge is not coming into the pupillary axis in a dilated pupil and the patient might be okay. That's if there's a lens subluxation. If there's a lens dislocation where there had been a rent or there has been trauma or if the lens is in the vitreous cavity, then it has to be removed.
Yeah.
The IOL has to be removed from the vitreous cavity, and then depending on the condition of the bag, either you implant a lens in the sulcus or do an iris claw lens. You know, entirely depending on what is the condition of the eye.
What is the condition? Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think one important point I think I catched from your presentation as well, that it's really important to look at the visual outcome. If it's affecting the vision.
If it's affecting,
Then it's something which patient will also complain and you have to manage. And
correct.
At the same time, look at the pressures and see if it's not
affecting. Look at everything. Is it causing any complication? Today on my examination, if I feel that the IOL has shifted a bit, but if the patient is not complaining, I am not going to mention that to them and cause them more anxiety.
Yeah, that's right.
If the patient is happy, if there are no other complications happening, you leave it, you follow it up.
That's right.
You know, so just seeing a condition is not important. It's also important to know what it is doing to the patient. Is the patient really affected by it?
Yeah.
Do you need to treat it or you just follow it up?
Great.
Yeah. Will nuclear sclerosis cataract induced myopia will go away after surgery? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Usually that's more on to, you know, IOLs, IOL power selection.
Yes. Because if whatever the cause of the myopia, whether it is an increased axial length or it is nuclear sclerosis, the IOL power calculation is going to take care of that. And our outcome, our aim is to make the patient emmetropic post-surgery.
This one, we'll just take it up. Most patients with cataract surgery comes with complaints of seeing about blue, violet, probably some change in color perception. If you have experience and if you think that's there routinely, what do you think would be the cause of that? Any comments on this?
Yeah, it depends a lot on the IOL designs. Okay, I have not, for this talk, I have not looked in too much into the different types of IOL designs and the different materials used. Okay, in my practice, it has been more common to see patients who come in and feel that things appear brighter and more colorful. They're not typically complaining of seeing things blue or violet. But yes, we do need to look at the different IOL and IOL coatings, IOL materials to kind of answer this question.
Yeah. One last question, I think, before we wrap up for this talk is, as a primary eye care practitioner, as we are following up our patients, the first part says that how frequently do you want to see patients post cataract surgery?
Yeah.
And what tests would you recommend us to do on every visit if there are no complaints? As you mentioned, I think the second part you probably have covered, VA, near vision, pinhole vision to make sure. But anything else you would want to talk on, and how frequently? Yeah. There's a frequency of follow-up.
Correct. So this really differs from surgeon to surgeon, because I know there are a lot of surgeons who might not even see the patient for a week post-surgery. I like to see all my patients on day one. Okay. This is important because, like I said, a lot of them can have some DM folds after surgery, Desme folds, corneal edema. These days, the expectations people have post-surgery is that post-surgery, the vision should be absolutely clear. So if they're having a little cloudy vision on day one and we are not seeing them, it can cause a lot of anxiety in their mind as to why is my vision still not clear. And sometimes adding in, just increasing the frequency of your topical steroids for a couple of days and adding in an hyperosmotic agent can help it to clear up much faster, which will be possible only if you see them on day one. Because most of the times by day 8, this would have anyways cleared. the anxiety that the patient might go through that 1 week, you know, you can avoid that by seeing them on the first day and explain to them that this is going to go. We just need to add these few drops. So I would typically see them on day one. Yes, if they have corneal edema, again, see them on day 4 or 5. If everything is fine, then call them a week later. And maybe after that, you know, explain the drops to them and then straight call them after 2 weeks, which would be 3 weeks post-surgery, where we can do a refraction for them. So it all depends on how the patient is doing on day one or on day 7.
Okay. I think.
And as optometrists, investigations, yes. Vision. And if you all are looking at slit lamp, look at the slit lamp to see how is the cornea. Main thing you want to see is how is the cornea, how is the inflammation.
Yeah. Great. And when would you finalize a prescription? What's the stage when you think I will now give glasses, or I would now want my optometrist to prescribe glasses to my patient who has done a cataract surgery?
Correct. So again, like I said, the expectations of people now post cataract surgery are very different. Yeah. I've had people who wanted to get their glasses done even before they go for the surgery, so that immediately after surgery, they have a pair of glasses ready. Okay. Yeah. But if not that, then definitely in the first week, most people want the glasses, especially if they're doing monofocal, because they need something for reading. Mm-hmm. So in which case, what I explain to them is, we can give you glasses. I can give you a prescription right now, knowing that it is likely to change a month later. So get it done with that in mind, that this is just going to help you tide over this period of 1 month. And typically, I think 1 month post-op, if everything else is fine, is a good time. Unless there are sutures to be removed, or unless there is something else going on, then you wait. Otherwise, give them a temporary prescription, which can even be done on day one or day two.
Okay.
And at the end of 1 month, finalize it.
Great. Sure. But before we end, this is one really, I think, to the point question is, with the advancement of technology of how cataract surgeries are done and with the advancement of IOLs, do you see the complication rates coming down? Does it relate to the advancement in technology, or it's more of a patient dependent problem?
I think it would be surgeon dependent.
Okay.
You know, it yes, definitely advancement in technologies and IOLs has led to a much better recovery rate, much faster healing, much faster visual recovery with our micro incisions and foldable IOLs and phaco. Okay. Yeah. Complication rate is still dependent on patient's pre-op condition, whether there is a pseudo exfoliation, whether it is a hard cataract, factors like that, and surgeon experience. So today, whether the patient is undergoing an SICS or a phaco, in the hands of an experienced surgeon, it's going to be fine. In the hands of a novel surgeon, the chances of complication are going to be a little higher. So definitely, improvement in technology has led to better recovery rates and healing, but might not directly be related to complication. Because in fact, phaco, for somebody who is learning a phaco emulsification, the chances of having a PC tear or corneal edema are higher than that same person doing an SICS in which he is experienced.
Okay. So probably it's a multifactorial thing.
It's a multifactorial thing, right? Definitely.
So it's not just one thing which reduces the complication. I think our role is to detect it at an early stage before it goes into the nightmare endophthalmitis, and treat the patients accordingly and refer them.
Because today, at the end of the day, it is a surgery which is going to have complications, sometimes even in the best of hands.
Yeah.
Like you very rightly said, the important thing is to pick it up on time, diagnose it, follow up the patient, monitor them. Do not let them feel ignored.
Yeah.
Take their symptoms seriously and, you know, give the necessary treatment. I think that is what is very important.
That is very important. Yeah. Great. So with that, I think thank you so much, Dr. Urmi, for your wonderful explanation and, you know, answering the questions and coming
thank
back
so
on OOLS for doing a talk.
Yes, it's wonderful to be back here with all of you. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. And I hope that this talk has been helpful. I hope that there have been pointers that, you know, they would take back and apply them in the clinical practice.
Definitely.
And for anybody who has any other doubts and wants to get in touch, I mean, anytime, there's not a problem.
Sure. So with that, thank you so much, everyone, for attending. We do have session planned next weekend. Until then, take care. Be safe. See you next week.
Thank you so much. See you. Bye.
Bye, Dr. Urmi.